Presently, he is holding the post of Joint Director at State Forensic Science Laboratory, Kerala. And before this, he was the Assistant Director of Polygraph Division for 10 years. And he contributed much in detecting deception in various criminal case investigations. Before this job, he was working as clinical psychologist, and his doctoral program was in cognitive psychology. I welcome you, sir, to preside this session.
Thank you, Lakshmi.
With that, I request all the participants to please mute your audio and switch off your video, and kindly post your queries in the chat box, which will be answered later by the speaker in the end of the session. Thank you. Sir, please. Pradeep, sir, yeah. I hand over this session to you.
Thank you, Lakshmi. So, I welcome all of you, all the participants, and to the 16th session of this webinar series conducted by Indian Criminology and Forensic Science Association. And our today's speaker is a very eminent personality in the field of detecting deception. She is working in the Institute of Behavioral Science at Gujarat Forensic University. And I have gone through her this thing, and I found that she has presented almost 58 research papers and published in various international journals. That itself shows her affinity to research programs, and she is a very eminent person in detecting deception, and she is the most appropriate person, I think, to deal with the topic that we have today. So I invite her to speak on. I am not taking too much of time, so I am inviting her to present the topic on detection of deception through modern forensic psychological investigation techniques. All participants are requested to strictly follow the guidelines mentioned by the organizers. Once again, I welcome Dr. Priyanka, and please start the session.
Thank you, sir. Respected Dr. Pradeep Saji, sir, the Joint Secretary, State Forensic Sciences Laboratory, Kerala. Moderator, ma'am, good morning. Who is a polygraph expert, and detection of deception starts with the polygraph itself. And my dear colleague, Dr. Siva Prasad. And I would also like to take name of my students who are part of this session. So I think after 3 or 4 months, we are going to be face to face through virtual world to interact with each other on a topic which is dearer to all the forensic psychologists, that is detection of deception through modern forensic psychological investigation techniques. There are multiple crimes that require investigation. We have only heard about murder, kidnapping, rape, but then there are other types of crime too that require forensic investigation.
Yes, ma'am, please carry on.
So I was telling that apart from murder, rape, and even the suicide require forensic investigation. So these are the types of crime that require forensic investigation, but then we are not aware that this can be investigated through forensic psychological techniques. Crimes like murder, kidnapping, bullying, whether it is a school, college, or at workplace, mob lynching, sexual abuse, not only related to rape, but then any sort of abuse, sexual assault, even sexual harassment, workplace harassment, the digital abuse, social media abuse, domestic violence, whether it is verbal, physical, or emotional, and also the child abuse. We can also do forensic psychological investigation in cyber crimes, like how to detect whether a person has done hacking, who is the right suspect out of number of suspects, fraud cases, cyber stalking, as well as cyber bullying. Terrorism is the most required crime where forensic psychological investigation techniques are required. Then there are stealing, elderly abuse, even elderly abuse is increasing, especially in this COVID time. White collar crimes like corruption, identity theft, mortgage, tax evasion, etc. So now the point is that forensic science investigation, which is based on collection of physical evidences like hair strand, blood, semen, bullet, murder weapon, suicide note, other documents and evidences which has fingerprints, footprints, etc. from the crime scene. So that is the job of forensic science expert. But how to prove that the physical evidences present and collected from the crime scene is actually belonging to the suspect who was present at the time of the crime and not before or after the crime? So how to prove that? Yes, physical evidences are available, but then those physical evidences cannot come forward and give a statement that the evidences were present at the time of crime. So the forensic sciences based investigation and testing can help us to check and cross-check whether the evidences matches with the DNA, fingerprints, footprints, handwriting, face of the suspect. But it's sometimes difficult to prove through physical evidence the presence as well as the intention of suspect at the crime scene. So for example, a suspect's fingerprint and footprint were found at the crime scene, and there is also CCTV footage of him entering the crime scene. But these evidences cannot prove that he has committed the crime unless he himself comes forward and confesses it, or if the victim is alive, the victim give his or her statement that yes, it has been done by this person, or an eyewitness come forward and then that person give a statement. Okay, now you have got certain statements by the suspect, the victim, if the victim is alive, and the eyewitnesses. But the next question that arises is how to find out whether the victim or eyewitness's statement is correct and it is not a false allegation, which we usually see in dowry cases, sexual harassment, abuse, as well as in corruption cases. Like in anti-corruption cases, there are complainants who are putting allegation on somebody else and that person is actually innocent. But then he has to undergo the entire investigation process to prove himself as an innocent person. And the another question that arises is, the suspect's statement is correct, whether he has confessed or he has denied the crime. Now, sometimes people do come forward, the suspect do come forward and confesses the entire crime. But that confession is done under pressure. For example, in one of the cases where the person was homosexual, he came forward and he confessed that I have committed the crime, I did the murder. But when further probing was done, forensic interview was done, he said that, see, I am suffering with HIV positive and anyways, I am going to die. So the person who has actually committed the crime, he has promised me that if I go and confess about the crime, then they will take care of my family. So whether the confession itself is correct or not, or when the person is denying. So mostly the suspect never accept their criminal act and they denies that they were not present or they have not done the crime. So in all these conditions, how to prove the innocence or guilty of a suspect? So in that case, we can use detection deception techniques, which are followed by a proper standard operating procedure, starting with the court's permission. Now, when a suspect is brought to us, we need to have court's permission. In court's permission, the court orders to undergo either polygraph, narco, brain electrical oscillation signature profiling. So the court permits to conduct one or the combination of multiple techniques on a suspect or the eyewitness. So after court's permission, the initial forensic interview is done at forensic lab. It cannot be done in police station. So the investigative officer bring the suspect to the forensic lab and there we do the proper forensic interview of the suspect, if required, witness, and in few cases, victims also. So after the interview, it is mandatory to conduct psychological assessment. This is done to find out whether the person is mentally stable or not. Sometimes we also get cases where we need to prove or we need to find out whether the person is faking mental illness or he is genuinely mentally ill. So in that case also, forensic psychological assessment is done. So once that is done and we find that the person is mentally stable, then only we can go for further investigation. Now, before starting any investigation, we have to give introduction about the tool need to be used on the subject. So if it is polygraph, we have to give a brief introduction about polygraph, but not the questions that we are going to ask in the polygraph testing. So what does polygraph does? It is safe. It is non-invasive technique. So such basic introductory information need to be provided to the subject. That is his own, that is his right to know about the procedure that he is going to undergo. After that, we take the consent of the subject. So just before going for the final recording, we take the consent of the subject. If subject denies, then we cannot proceed further with the recording. Even if we have done all the forensic interview, psychological assessment, but if consent is not there, we cannot proceed forward. However, if the subject is not giving consent, that means there is some problem with the subject suspect which he is trying to hide. So that might go against the subject. So we always try to convince the subject to give the consent. That will be for his own benefit. Once the consent is given, then the recording of the suspect is done using either one of the techniques or combination of techniques. Now let us see what are the techniques which can be used for extraction of information. As I said that we start with the forensic interview. In Gujarat Forensic Sciences University, we have a special setup which forensic labs doesn't have, that we have an interview room where the suspect sits at one side and the investigative officer on the other side of the table. And from another room, the forensic experts can observe the entire interaction happening between the investigative officer and the suspect. And the entire recording is audio-video recorded, CD is prepared, and it is submitted to the court. So right now we have started with the anti-corruption cases where all the questions are being prepared by the forensic expert, and the IO is supposed to ask the questions in front of us. If required, in between, we can use the mic to give instructions to the investigative officer to probe more. Or if we want to ask any question, we can ask from the suspect directly. So everything is being recorded with the timing. So there is no chance of manipulation if people are thinking that it's a technology based and manipulation can be done. No, timing, date, everything is being recorded. And we start the recording when the subject enters and when the subject exits. So the entire process is being recorded, converted into CD and presented to the court. Now the first technique, which is the oldest technique, is polygraph, also known as lie detector. Most of the forensic labs have polygraph all over the India. In fact, world is also using polygraph since 1920. So it started with the blood pressure and galvanic skin response. But later, as the advancement in the technology took place, they have included a few more physiological parameters to the polygraph. Here you can see the old polygraph where there is a paper and when a response is given, that is being recorded on the paper. This is new polygraph system, which is laptop based, easier to conduct. And you can see all the graph on the computer screen. So there is no need of paper and there is no chance of losing that paper sheet. So everything is stored in the computer and it can be analyzed using the computer. Now, when we talk about the procedure of polygraph examination, apart from forensic interview, we have to conduct separate interview for polygraph examination because here we need to prepare questions. Now, these questions are combination of relevant, irrelevant, and control questions. Total 12 to 15 questions can be asked, and all the questions shall be answered in either yes or no. So in order to prepare those questions, we need to go for pre-test interview, especially for preparing questions for the polygraph recording. Once pre-testing is pre-interview is done, then the actual interrogation and recording using the instrument is done, where the subject sits on the polygraph chair with all the physiological parameters attached, and then the recording is done. Questions are asked, the person is supposed to answer yes or no, and the recording is done. And then the post-test interview is done just to find out whether the person wants to say something which has happened between the recording and he wants to express something, or if we have seen any problem during the recording or for a specific question, then in order to clarify that, we can go for post-test interview. So here you can see that the subject is sitting comfortably with the different accessories attached to his body. This is BP. Then for respiration, we have two respiration accessories, upper and lower. Galvanic skin response. And now there is one more accessory attached, which is for movement. Now, whenever there is an urge to tell a lie, the person will move. So just before asking a question or just after asking a question, if there is a movement, then that shows some sort of deception. However, that is not the only parameter using which we can find out the deception. It's the combination of all the physiological parameters shown on the chart when questions are asked. So again, you can see that all the accessories are attached, and the forensic expert can see the graphs on the screen, and accordingly the questions are asked. Now in new polygraph system, the questions can be asked by the system also. You just need to feed all the questions that you want to ask with the proper timing, 30 seconds time in between two questions, and the system can ask questions automatically. You just need to put answer responded by the subject. So whether the subject has responded yes or no, you just need to put that, mark that answer in the system. How reliable it is? 85 to 95% accuracy rate. Now, earlier when the older polygraph was used, the accuracy rate was less because the recording was done three times with a 5 minutes gap in between, and three charts were produced. We used to compare these charts. Now, as per the new polygraph system, So in chart comparison, there has to be change appear in two or more than two charts. So when chart comparison was done, then the changes should be shown in at least two charts. If it is shown only in one chart, then it cannot be considered. So two or more than two charts showing changes as compared to the baseline for a relevant question, that means there is some sort of deception. But then there, that chart comparison was very subjective in nature. So in order to standardize the polygraph technique, new polygraph system has come out, advanced polygraph system, which has scoring system. And based upon that scores, you will get, if the score is between 0 to 5, that means there is no deception. If the score is above 5, that means there is a deception. So that scoring is a complex task, but then that will give more accurate answer, and that's how the accuracy of polygraph has increased. A case study, four subjects underwent polygraph testing. That was a murder case of a related to property fight. So out of four, subject A and subject B, they were trying to hide the truth which was found through the polygraph testing, and the remaining two were not at all related to the crime scene and the sub and the victim who got murdered. So through polygraph testing, it was found that the two suspects, apart from A and B, were telling the truth, and there was no deception through the polygraph testing. Next is suspect detection system, which is used mainly for screening of suspects. It cannot be used as full-fledged, single-handedly forensic investigation technique, but if you have 100, more than 10 suspects or multiple suspects, and you want to find out whether the suspect is actually involved in the crime scene or not, for that suspect detection system can be useful. Usually used on at border for border security and airports also. So here in this suspect detection system, the procedure is very simple. The subject has to sit with his hand inside the cradle. A laptop is kept in front of him. The questions are presented auditorily and visually. So if the person is visually impaired, he can listen to the probes, questions, and if he is completely normal, then he can read as well as listen to the questions. Now, for each question, he has to answer in terms of yes or no. Mostly guilty knowledge test is done through the SDS system. The questionnaire includes relevant and non-relevant questions, and like polygraph, three recordings are done. Here, four sets are given. If a suspect is showing deception, then in four sets, the deception can be detected. If he is innocent, then two more sets are given in order to find out whether there is any deception or not. So any sort of concealed information is there with the subject that can be detected using suspect detection system. For this SDS, court's permission is not needed. But yes, consent of the subject is required. So again, coming back to the procedure of SDS, the subject is supposed to sit comfortably, place palm in the sensor's cradle, put headphone on the ears, answer sets of questions. Questions are presented both in text and audio by the system. And sensors measures the psychophysiological responses. It's the GSR response that the need to tell a lie produces sweat, and that sweating can be detected through the system. There was a case in 2008. It was a serial bomb blast case, a very prominent case. It happened in Ahmedabad. Total 36 people were killed and 76 were injured. Six suspects were under SDS investigation, and only one suspect showed deception, who was then taken for further forensic investigation. Now, the problem with the SDS and one more system, that is LVA, we cannot conclude on the basis of the result that we have got through SDS and LVA. We have to club it with other forensic investigation techniques. And it would be much better if we can connect polygraph with other investigation technique, SDS with other investigation techniques. That will give us more prominent response about the suspect's involvement. Next is layered voice analysis. So it's a technology, Israel-based technology, which enables to understand subject's mental state as well as the emotional makeup. So when a person is telling lie, there are changes in the voice parameters of the subject. So that change in voice parameter is being detected by layered voice analysis. So when a person is responding to questions, the speech pattern, the voice modulation, everything gets recorded by the system, and the system shows whether there is surety, unsurety, stress, emotional arousal in the subject's speech. So it's the voice that gets analyzed. So under the LVA investigation, there was a triple murder case where initially three people were missing and then they were found dead in their own farmhouse well. So three suspects underwent LVA testing, online and offline both. So online meaning when a person is speaking and the system is detecting the voice and giving instant result. Offline is a audio recorded audio recording data is being analyzed using the system. So there are two ways: live interaction and the system detects whether there is any issue, or a recorded audio can also be tested using LVA. So out of three, one of the suspects showed deception and indicated that he possessed the knowledge about the murder weapon also, and he was also able to remember that he was under alcohol intoxication, and because of that he did the murder, but then later on he realized that he has done something wrong and he ran away. However, the other two suspects did not show any deception regarding the information they shared with the investigative officer. Next is the most controversial technique, narcoanalysis, because it is the only invasive technique used in India. However, it is banned in all over the world from past many years. The problem with the narcoanalysis is that a drug is being injected in the person's body to bring that person in a drowsy state, and then the questions are asked in that drowsy state. Now the controversy is that you are injecting a drug, you are giving pain to the subject without knowing whether the subject is actually innocent or guilty. So people have spoken ill about it. They have criticized the entire technique. We don't know whether the drug has any side effect or not. Irrespective of all these things, we are getting results, and for forensic investigation, one clue can lead to solving a complex case. So yes, there are problems with the narcoanalysis because of its invasiveness in administration, but then it can be a useful technique. Narcoanalysis has solved a very complex case and very well-known case, Abu Salim case, where after doing a narcoanalysis interrogation, it was found that the murder of real estate developer Pradeep Jain in Bombay in 1995 was done by Abu Salim. And there were many other information gathered through narcoanalysis, which was not... which forensic experts were not able to do using polygraph. Forensic hypnosis is actually a replacement of narcoanalysis, because narco is injection of drug. Here in forensic hypnosis, there is no drug required. It's just the verbal suggestions given to the subject. But till now, it has not been practiced as forensic investigation technique in India. We are trying to develop it, but let's see how much time it will take to come out with a case and related conclusion. It is again a controversial technique, but American Psychological Association has accepted the technique as clinical for clinical investigation. But now forensic experts are also utilizing this technique for understanding the memory issues and boosting up the confidence of eyewitnesses as well as victims. Now, there are certain questions related to hypnotic trance, whether the person is actually under trance or not. So that can be tested using EEG technique, where it shows that there are no similarity between hypnosis and sleep. So suppose if the person come out of trance and say that I was sleeping, through EEG recording, we can check whether he was actually under trance or he was faking it. Also, there was a research work which said that there is a difference between wakefulness and the consciousness when a person is under hypnotic trance. So the electrical recording shown on EEG is different when the person is in awakened state as compared to the trance state. So it's not an awakened state, it's a subconscious state of mind from where we can retrieve information, especially for those memories which have been forgotten by the victim or the suspect or by the eyewitness. So here the procedure is pre-hypnosis interview is taken in order to find out whether the person has any phobia or any issue related to the crime scene that we are going to investigate. Especially it can be used for rape victims to gather more information in the through the subconscious mind, which is not possible using the conscious state of mind where the person is already in a very fearful and distressed state. So once the pre-hypnosis is done, induction is done using either the pendulum technique or there are other techniques like eye fixation, breath watching, etc. Then when the person is under hypnotic trance, then the information eliciting questions are being asked. Now this entire procedure is done under audio video recording. So for forensic hypnosis, even for narcoanalysis, audio video recording is must. For forensic hypnosis, a prior standard script need to be prepared, and then only we can go for questioning or information eliciting process during the hypnotic trance. After the satisfactory question answer round, we can go for dehypnotizing the subject, and then post hypnosis interview is done just to find out whether he is feeling comfortable or not, and then we leave the subject. So it can be used to make the subject feel relaxed for the criminal proceedings as well as trials for better recall of memories. The next technique is brain fingerprinting, which is also known as brain mapping, P300, ERP based P300 technique. In this technique, the subject is supposed to be sitting in front of a computer and various stimuluses are presented to him or her, and the subject has to look at that stimuluses one by one. Now the assumption is that if a perpetrator has done the crime related information is stored in the person's brain. So till now, what we have discussed about deception of detection, we have measured physiological parameters using polygraph. We have measured galvanic skin response, the sweating. We have used the voice analysis. We have used the subconscious mind. And now we are entering the brain. So how memory can lead to forensic investigation, that is done through brain fingerprinting. So when the stimuluses related to the crime scene are presented one by one, the subject brain responds in a particular manner. So that response is shown in terms of EEG recording as P300. So if I show you a stimulus, suppose this is the stimulus, and I ask you, what is it? You will take 4 to 5 seconds to respond that this is a pen or a rubber. But before responding verbally, the brain has already responded in 300 milliseconds, and that shows that the brain has recognized the stimulus. So if you ask a person whether you have used this weapon or not, the person will deny that, no, this is not the weapon. I don't know that this is the weapon. I was not present. But if you show the weapon as stimulus in front of the subject, the brain of the subject will automatically respond if he recognizes the murder weapon. Similarly, the face of the victim or eyewitnesses can be shown various photographs of the suspects, and then they can recognize it. But the problem with the brain fingerprinting is that though the brain has capability to recognize the stimulus, but then that recognition could be on the basis of familiarity of the subject stimulus, or the person has actually witnessed that stimulus. For example, even an IO, investigative officer, has all the information related to the physical evidences present at crime scene, apart from the perpetrator. So in that case, that differentiation is not possible through brain fingerprinting. But that completely cannot be said that we have to reject brain fingerprinting. It cannot be used for forensic investigation. No, it can be used only for recognition of certain stimuluses. But then further investigation need to be done in order to find out whether the person was actually present and he has committed the crime. So now that is entirely a big and complex question, how to prove that. So that answer can be answered in the next technique. But before that, I would like to discuss the Supreme Court's judgment, where it has given criticism about polygraph, narcoanalysis, and brain fingerprinting. The criticism is about the right against self-incrimination. A person cannot give statement against himself, and that cannot be used as an evidence in front of court. And the second point is that it includes cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. Now, both the points are actually incorrect, though it has been, the judgment is given by Supreme Court, but then it's not correct, because till now, whatever technique that I have discussed is totally humane in nature, consent is taken, and if a person with his own consent giving a statement, then that cannot be denied. We can use that. And unless we ask questions from the subject, how we will get to know what has happened on that day? So this right against self-incrimination is actually not justified in when a forensic investigation need to be done. Okay, somebody has asked, can you once again say about brain fingerprinting? All right. Brain fingerprinting is a technique which is used to recognize a stimulus. Suppose I want to find out whether the subject has information about the weapon, the murder weapon he has used for commitment of crime. Okay, I'll get to next question again. Let me answer the brain fingerprinting one first. So suppose a picture of a gun, picture of a knife, picture of a rod, iron rod is shown to the person. Now, which stimulus has produced P300 in the person's brain? Through that, we can find out, we can say that, okay, the person has recognized the murder weapon. But then the accuracy is low, because suppose he has responded to a gun, the picture of a gun, and he is a hardcore criminal. He might have used thousands of guns earlier also for different types of crime. So that accuracy is missing when we are using brain fingerprinting. And that is why till now, not a single case has been done using brain fingerprinting. Delhi Forensic Lab has recently bought the instrument. So if they come forward with a solution of a case, with a judgment, then that will be a different case. But the researches that we have done in our institute on brain fingerprinting, we have not got any result pertaining to forensic investigation. So it's from my side as an expert, forensic expert, as well as a researcher, I can say that the brain fingerprinting cannot be helpful in proper forensic investigation. Yes, so Amani has asked, to what extent information retrieved or detected by human memory is reliable? Yes, so we have done a research work. I'll come to that technique and then I'll answer your question. The next technique is, yes, so I was talking about the torture and inhuman nature of forensic investigation technique. If a child can undergo EEG recording to find out whether he is suffering with an epilepsy attack or not, if a sleep study is done using all these parameters attached to the person when the person is sleeping, and that sleep is uncomfortable. You can imagine that if you are sleeping with all these parameters attached with you, it will be a very uncomfortable sleep. It is done with the old age people. You are undergoing thousands of surgeries using all these techniques, which are torturesome. But in order to save your life, you are using all these techniques. Then why can't we use it for forensic investigation? It is also a matter of life and death. And if all these instruments, parameters is not affecting the child's brain, elderly people's brain, an adult's brain, physiological parameter, then how the techniques that we are using is having a bad effect on the suspect's body? So that's a big question that I feel that I should ask all the advocates working in court. So the next technique, which is which was developed in India, known as brain electrical oscillation signature profiling. It was developed by Professor C.R. Mukundan, based at Bangalore. He was a former director, Department of Psychology, NIMHANS, is an internationally patented technology, which is not brain mapping. Usually people call it as brain mapping, but it is not brain mapping. And it is not a brain fingerprinting technique also. Now the assumption about while using BIOS is, in short, we say call it BIOS, brain electrical oscillation signature profiling, that when a crime is done, the perpetrator has all the information right from planning, plotting about the crime, visiting the crime scene, the entire interaction with the victim, and then the running away from the crime scene. So all this information is stored in the person's memory in brain. So we can say that we have a hard disk in our brain, which is known as brain memory system as episodic memory. Now here, till now we have talked about the deception, whether the person is trying to hide any information or not. But the question is, okay, he is hiding, but what exactly he is hiding? He is hiding that he possesses the information, he know the suspect, or he was himself present at the crime scene. So the BIOS measures the experience of an individual. If you have done it, the memory is stored in your brain and that cannot be removed at all. So the question asked by Amani, that whether the memory retrieved is reliable or not. Yes, through BIOS, if it is being probed, cued, and then if we get experiential knowledge-based response, then it is a reliable thing. Suggestibility, yes, we can suggest a person to remove a memory, to confabulate a memory, but then that is at a very superficial level, which doesn't go back to his memory lane. So when the BIOS testing is done, that confabulated memory cannot affect the actual memory. Now again, the right of self-incrimination, that the subject statement cannot be used against himself, and the torture point, here in BIOS, we are not asking any question to the subject. It is very surprising that we are just presenting cues in front of the subject. The subject is sitting comfortably and listening to those probes, and the brain is automatically responding to all those probes. Now, these probes are very small, general questions, like, my name is Dr. Priyanka. I am working at Gujarat Forensic Sciences University. On 5th of July, I gave a lecture on deception of detection using different techniques. So these are the probes which are presented in front of the subject. The subject need to sit comfortably with the eyes closed and listen to all these probes. The brain will respond to these probes. If the person has actually experienced it, the brain will respond automatically in terms of experiential knowledge. And it has high sensitivity and high specificity. Those who are from psychology background, they know that for a good test, psychological test, it must have reliability, validity, norms and standardization. Similarly, for a good forensic investigation technique, it must have specificity and sensitivity, which is very high for BIOS recording. So here you can see that the subject is sitting with the EEG cap, and the cap is very comfortable. Here, don't get panicked because a syringe was shown. It is just to inject saline gel to get the brain activity. It is it is a blunt needle which doesn't harm the subject. So in these holes, the saline gel is inserted, and that helps in the connectivity with the neurons of the brain and to get the EEG data. Now again, for BIOS recording, COATS permission is required. In COATS permission, it has to be written that BIOS testing needs to be done. Again, the forensic interview is done, psychological assessment is done. If the person is showing any sort of instability, brain instability, we cannot go for BIOS recording. If the person is suffering with heart problem, physiological issue, again, we cannot go for BIOS recording. But once the psychological assessment is proper, clean, then we have to introduce about the entire technique to the subject. Based upon the introduction about the BIOS, the probe designing is done, where two sets are prepared. One set is the investigative officer's version. Till now, in all the techniques, we have seen that the statements are given by investigative officer and not by the subject. Here we are giving equal opportunity to the subject to give his or her own statement, which can be checked using BIOS recording. So there are two sets. One is investigative officer's version, where he will present his theory why he is suspecting that this suspect is a guilty person, and the suspect's version, what he want to say, that he was present, not present, whatever statement he want to give, that is being recorded, and based on that probes are prepared. Once this process is done, then again, just before going for final recordings, consent of the subject is taken. At that point, if again the subject is not ready or he is not giving his consent, we cannot do BIOS recording. But then it might go against the subject. So we try to convince the subject to undergo the recording. And once the consent is given, we show all the probes to the subject. So there is no hiding. It's completely transparent investigation where the subject knows what are the probes that are going to be presented during the investigation, during the recording. And then recording of both the sets A and B are done on the suspect one by one. Now, whose set has shown more number of experiential knowledge-based response? So here you can see the list of probes. We have combination of three different types of probe. One is neutral, control, and the relevant type of probes. Neutral probes are just to prepare the baseline of the EEG. Then the control questions, for which the person has given his consent that yes, his name is this, this age, he is working here, the marital status. And then the relevant probes related to the crime scene. Now these probes are based upon investigative officer's version that he was present. And the next set B, based upon the suspect, which says that I was not present. So both the sets are being analyzed automatically by the system, and the report is generated in this manner. Now, if these steps are shown in the recording, in the report, that means for this particular probe, the person has shown experiential knowledge. So red, green, yellow is strong experiential knowledge-based responses. Probes which are not showing any strips, that means there is no experiential knowledge attached to these probes. Now, this particular case is about a domestic violence case where we have started a research work which is funded by ICSSR. Till now, all the investigations are done on the suspect. Now, we are trying to convert that investigation from a victim's point of view. The victim who has underwent abuse, that experience will be much stronger than who has done that act. So especially for domestic violence case and sexual abuse case, we are doing a research work. She is one of our subjects who said that she underwent physical as well as verbal abuse, and these trips showed that she has actually underwent verbal as well as physical abuse. So it will be easier for the victim to present in front of court that she has, she or he, even a man can undergo sexual abuse or sexual harassment. So they can prove, they can present their point of view in front of the court that yes, they have actually underwent sexual harassment or domestic violence, or they haven't done domestic violence. It's a false allegation. So in both the cases, it can be used for investigation process in front of the court. Few cases related to BIOS. It shall be noted that BIOS is not done independently. In order to do BIOS, one has to undergo polygraph if required narco, and then BIOS. It cannot be done directly with the investigation cannot be done directly with the BIOS recording. So you start with the polygraph. If there is any deception, then we can go for BIOS recording. So there was a serial killing case, very popular case, Noida case. You must have heard about Nithari Kand. So in that case, BIOS testing was done, and through BIOS testing, it was found that the person has committed murder of 14 kids, and the entire modus operandi came out through BIOS. How he used to kidnap those kids, which color cloth were that kid was wearing, how he cut the body parts of those kids into different pieces, and how he disposed of those body parts. And he also did molestation after killing the child. So it was like very cruel crime which he has done. And he has also eaten the flesh of the kids, which also got detected using BIOS system, which was not, the information was not available through polygraph or any other investigation technique. Then there was a serial bomb blast case where 13 suspects were brought for polygraph as well as for BIOS. In polygraph, it showed that all the 13 suspects are showing deception. But when BIOS testing was done, it was found that, yes, they all were part of some sort of terrorism-based activity. But out of 13, only 7 were involved in that particular bomb blast case. So accordingly, the further investigation and proceedings were done on those 7 suspects. Now, this dowry case is very classic case for BIOS testing as well as in any sort of forensic investigation, because in this dowry case, the dying declaration was given by the victim that she was burnt by her in-laws and she died after giving the statement. Now, dying declaration is the ultimate evidence which can be used in court, and nobody can deny, challenge that statement. But the in-laws said that they were not present on that day when she got burned. They were not there in the house. And she spoke a lie. We don't know why she did that. But then if you are not ready to accept our statement, we are ready to undergo BIOS. And it was demanded by the suspects to undergo BIOS testing. Through BIOS testing, it was found that they were really not involved. They were not present at the crime scene. So further investigation was done, and it was found that on the day of her death, her brother insisted her to give such statements so that he can get benefit of her property. So with that investigation, he got into he got imprisonment, and the in-laws are now outside the jail. Animal poaching case. Very famous Gir animal poaching case where 17 suspects were brought for polygraph and BIOS testing. In BIOS testing, it was found that out of 17 suspects, few were involved in the planning and plotting. They did not kill the tiger. Few were involved in catching the tiger, and few were involved in the the killing of the tiger. So that discrimination is also possible through BIOS testing. Then there was a rape and murder case. A suspect was charged with rape as well as murder case. He underwent polygraph, narco, and BIOS testing. So polygraph and narco showed that, yes, he is showing deception. There are clues related to his involvement in rape, but no clues about the murder. In BIOS, it was found that, yes, he did rape of the victim, but then the murder was done by somebody else. He committed that rape and then he left the crime scene. further investigation was done and it was found that because the victim got was raped, so his husband got disturbed and he killed her to protect his respect in the society. So the case was rape come murder, but then the suspects were two different people. There was a kidnapping case. Case was brought to investigate the kidnapping of a minor child, but the investigation through BIOS showed that the minor child was not only kidnapped, raped, and then murdered, and the body was hid in somewhere in the jungle. So all this information were brought through BIOS, which was then shared with the investigative officer, and they could locate the dead body of the child. So till now, more than 300 cases has underwent BIOS testing, and mostly the complex cases. Again, coming back to that question, Amina's question, that whether we can confabulate our memory or not. So there was a research.
Excuse me, ma'am. Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
You can answer the question at the end of the session, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Fine. So there are a few researches done by our students at the Gujarat Forensic Sciences University. So suppose if we repeat same information in front of the suspect, will that affect the memory of the person? So the research work says that no, it cannot. You cannot confabulate the memory and you cannot affect the person's experiential knowledge by repeating a repetition of information. It can be used for cybercrime investigation also, where usually we are unable to prove that this person has committed hacking or cybercrime. So in that case, BIOS testing can be used. And it doesn't matter whether the memory is recent one or the remote one. In both the cases, you will be able to retrieve your memory without any problem, unless you have a brain dysfunction. Next technique is, which is very new and upcoming technique, new in terms of that now people have started using it. Otherwise, it is a very old technique. It began in 1958, but now we are using it for suicidal cases, drowning cases, and mostly if the case is of equivocal death. Death which is not clear. So it seems that it is a suicide, but then it could be a murder also. So in such cases, psychological autopsies can be used. Now, forensic investigation, we have started with the suspect when he is in conscious state, and we can go for investigation when the suspect, victim, offender is dead. So the entire investigation is related to the entire body if a person is alive or dead. So we can do all sort of investigation using these techniques. Now there are some upcoming techniques. One is eye tracking device, why to leave eyes also, because eyes can also tell the truth. So if your pupil is dilating or constricting, that means there is some deception. So on what question it is dilating or contracting. So that can be detected using eye tracking device. Next is micro expressions. Till now, when we are doing forensic interview, we are depending upon the body language of the suspect, how he is responding. So in that case, we are dependent upon six different aspects, like listen to how they say and what they say, but then this can be manipulated. Watch their body language. They are uncomfortable, but then they will sit comfortably in front of you just to present that they are confident and whatever they are saying is a truth. Direct and direct irregular emotional pattern. If they are faking psychological problem instability, then there could be a change in emotional pattern, which can be a fake emotional pattern. Recognize awkward interaction, like big pauses in between the answers given by the subject. Study subtle facial expressions. The person is smiling or the person is showing sad face. He is showing that, no, I am not involved and I am so bichara type. So those expressions are shown by the person and the eye movement, whether the person is maintaining eye contact or there is lot of eye movement. So these are the body language related parameters, but then these can be faked. What a person cannot fake or hide is the micro expressions that is related to your facial expressions. Now, if a person is smiling, that smile could be a fake smile if there is no micro expression based changes in the cheeks and the lips of the person. So that is being detected by the software. Again, at GFSU, we are doing a research work. Maybe in 1 or 2 years, we will come out with the result. But forensic labs has understood the importance of micro expressions and they are in process of procuring it. The next technique is social media analytics, which I got to know very recently through this platform only. I am very thankful to Siva Prasad sir who allowed me to attend that webinar. So this is something new for me and it is a very interesting software which helps in understanding the behavioral science of crime and the criminals using social media. So if you want to track the criminal act of an individual on social media, this software can be of great help. So it can detect with whom you are connected. So this is the main person, the offender, and he is connected with how many people. Now this could be an offender or an innocent, but then he is directly or indirectly connected with many people through social media. Now that social media could be Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp. You talk about any social media, it can detect all those portals. So I'm really impressed with this technique. If you go further, then you can see that the person is related some or the other way related with jihad propaganda or some other antisocial activity. And also it can also detect where the person is located. So not only in India, it can locate the presence of the person all over the world. So from where he is channelizing his criminal act. Now talking about all these techniques, there is need of the hour, which we all need to understand as a forensic expert, as a student, as a lawyer, and as a general public. First, please accept the advanced technologies for forensic investigation. Have trust, go for result-based conclusions. If the technique is not able to give you any conclusion, reject it. But just because it is a technique, technology-based technique, and you are rejecting it, don't do that. Because nowadays, technology is much better than our manual investigation. Crime scene visit shall be done by special forensic task force, which shall consist of one police officer, two forensic science experts, one forensic psychology expert, forensic photographer, and police constable, one male and one female. We need to formulate a standard SOP for forensic investigation. And for that, the forensic expert team shall recommend the type of forensic investigation techniques after analysis of the case under investigation. The team shall be independent to work and give report. So it should not be governed by a police officer who is ordering forensic expert to write a report in certain manner and give it to them. No, it shall be done by the forensic expert, the team of the forensic expert, which will be including a police officer also. But then the report shall be prepared by the forensic expert and it shall be presented in front of the court directly in a confidential manner. So if a lawyer wants to see that report, he has to collect it from the court. The report shall be confidential and submitted directly to the court. Interference of any other agency shall not be permitted, especially media. If you want to know about it, you can talk to the forensic expert once the case is complete. These regular updates are not acceptable. It's improper because it is not only affecting the general public, but also the family of the victim. it's a very torturesome experience for the family members who has recently lost their family member, and then media is promoting the entire crime as a crime. Sharing of crime related details on social media by public without formal permission shall be considered as serious offense. The forensic investigation team work shall start from the crime scene. So the team will start their work from the crime scene until the judgment is given by the court. So the entire case shall be seen by a particular forensic expert team. That can include a police officer also. I am not excluding police officer. Only the concerned people directly related to the case shall get timely update about the case. It shall not be made public to avoid mental trauma faced by the family members, relatives, especially the victim in case of rape or sexual abuse. The Special Forensic Task Force shall start the practice of publishing. Yes, we are not publishing our cases. We shall start publishing our cases in reputed journals for future forensic experts, for our students, for upcoming forensic experts, for their training and understanding. And general public, if they want to know about the case, no problem. They shall be motivated to get all the updates about the case they are interested in, but from the articles and papers published by forensic experts, that too in a reputed journals, and the final judgment given by the court. So with this, I thank Pradeep sir, Lakshmi ma'am, and Siva sir for giving me an opportunity to speak on the very much required topic, that is detection of deception through forensic techniques. Thank you.
Ma'am, you can answer for the questions asked.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. So, next question is by Sandra. Can an expert criminal manipulate the polygraph technique? Yes, polygraph technique one can manipulate, but then if the polygraph technique expert is an expert, then he will get to know that the person is trying to manipulate. And that is why I said that only one technique is not enough. If you feel that there is any sort of deception, one must go with another combination of other techniques. Using of any one technique is not suggested. Question by Apoorva. Ma'am, I listened somewhere an extreme pain can manipulate lie detector test results. Is this true? Extreme pain has started when? From the beginning, then in the baseline also the pain will have an effect. So it doesn't matter whether the pain the person is suffering with any pain throughout the session, then it will be easier from polygraph to detect lie, to detect deception. But if the pain is inserted during the recording, then it will be a difficult task. And again, the answer is that don't go with one technique, use combination of techniques. And if the person is an expert who is using polygraph, he or she can detect that the answers are being manipulated, whether it is pain inflicted or any other technique has been used. Arvind has given consent. He is with me. He has agreed that true, ma'am, during medical examination, blood is drawn from the suspect for toxicologic examination. So if that is not torturesome, then how this one is torturesome? It cannot be called inhuman as these techniques. Okay, this is the feedback. Okay, ma'am, Nimmo has asked, will application of linguistics in detecting deception will be effective as other techniques? In all these techniques, we are using language, preferred language of the suspect. So in polygraph, if the person is from South, his language can be used. If he is from Gujarat, Gujarati language can be used. Same is with BIOS, NARCO. So the entire investigation is done in their preferred language. What is the animal poaching? Animal poaching is killing animals, illegal killing of animals in wild forests. Yes, Arvind has answered that question. Can social media, a question by Amani, can social media analytics be adopted for investigation on suspects? What about the claim or right to privacy? Guilt is not proven yet to compromise certain fundamental rights of individuals. So the investigation will be done only after a suspect is caught and the proceedings are going on, not just without any reason. Investigation cannot be done. There has to be a FIR, a crime registered, and then the forensic investigation is done. At present, the cases are given to forensic lab only after court order, and such team is non-existent on crime scene. That's true, and that's why I have suggested that the crime scene visit shall be done by a forensic expert, a team of forensic experts, and the list I have already mentioned. Likita has asked, ma'am, for the hypnosis which is used in the investigation, would one need a diploma certificate in hypnosis? Yes, you need a diploma or a training certificate. Without that, you cannot practice hypnosis. And how many of them use this technique? In India, I'm trying to use it, but we tried to do a research work. Even Aditya, who is my dissertation student, he wanted to do it, but this COVID did not allow us to do complete that research work. Otherwise, I would have answered your question. Other than Gujarat Forensic Sciences University, nobody is using forensic hypnosis. But in abroad, it is very well used. Is any drug given before hypnosis? No. In hypnosis, no drug is required. It's just the verbal suggestions given to the subject to bring that person into subconscious state of mind. Is there any social platform from where we can get updates from upcoming webinars? That is for Shiva sir. The issue is not being about being harmful to human body, but it's a legal right of suspect to refuse providing evidence against himself. Yes, it's his legal right, but then that means you are a suspect and you are a guilty person. If you are innocent, then why you are not giving your consent? Suppose a person is assuming or thinking that he is suffering with cancer, he has to undergo medical test in order to find out whether he is actually suffering with cancer or not. Similarly, if he want to prove himself as innocent, what is wrong in undergoing the forensic investigation technique? If he is a genuine person, if he is really innocent. Is hypnosis, the question is asked by Apoorva, is hypnosis is one of the best technique used in criminology? It could be, it can become one of the best technique in criminology because you are studying the causal factors. So if you understand the reason behind commitment of crime, you can manipulate that using hypnosis. But then for that, you have to have training in hypnosis, how to use proper script, standard script in order to deal with the causal factors of criminal act. So yes, if you can use it as a trained hypnotherapist, you can do wonders with hypnosis as such. Savitri, ma'am, I have a doubt. In forensic psychosis, subject suggestibility also do matters. Yes. When we go for forensic investigation, any forensic investigation, we have to conduct forensic psychological assessment. If in that assessment, if we get to know that the person has some sort of mental disability or instability, we cannot go for forensic investigation. We cannot go for forensic hypnosis also. So in that case, suggestibility will have negative reverse effect. It's better to go for clinical hypnosis to deal with that psychosis, and later on we can go for forensic investigation. Psychosis is the question asked by Arvind. What is psychosis? Psychosis is like depression, the mild form of mental issues. Amani, right to remain silence is just existing at superficial level. I think so. Further probes demand them to accept one or the other assessments. I couldn't get your question. Right to remain silence is just existing at superficial level. But if you remain silent, how you will protect yourself? That is my question. If you want to prove yourself innocent, you have to speak. Any superior criminal beat hypnosis technique? Question asked by Apoorva. For any technique, you have to have skill and training. Without training, you cannot use the technique. And if you are untrained, then obviously anybody can fool you. So it's not the technique which the person is fooling, it's the technique used by the expert whom the suspect can fool. So if you don't know how to use polygraph, you don't know how to prepare questions, you don't know how to prepare probes, anybody can fool you. You cannot blame the technique that the technology is useless. No, you don't know how to use the technology. Harsh, is there any history in India where principles of Stockholm syndrome has been used by investigators to collect from an offender in a manner that two sets of investigators, cold and warm, both are left to function offender strategically without offender knowledge of such sets implemented on him, and something fruitful can be extracted by the warm team? I think that is related to police investigation and not by the forensic investigator. We are not using warm, cold type of investigation. We do face-to-face interaction with the suspect and with full transparency that whatever we are asking, that is unbiased question, and we are neutral. We are not in favor or against you. So whatever you will say, that will go as it is in our report. We are not doing the functioning of a police investigator, police officer. Lakshmi ma'am. Ma'am, I have an experience that a famous hypnotherapist reported a subject to the innocent, to be innocent, but he was later found to be deceptive in polygraph. He was convicted by the court. So, please, if you can share further details about this case, because why the person was shown as innocent? Because hypnotherapy doesn't give that sort of report that the person is innocent or guilty. It can only show the statement given by the subject. So whosoever has done that therapy and prepared the report, the person has done some sort of foul play in the reporting. Because we, as a hypnotherapist, we cannot give final report that the person is innocent or guilty. And even polygraph cannot help in finding out whether the person is innocent or guilty. It can only show whether the person is trying to hide any information, if there is any deception. Now, what is that deception that need to be further investigated? And that's where we are lacking. We are doing half investigation. Polygraph is giving us half result. Now, that half remaining result need to be further investigated using various techniques. Hypnotherapy can also be used to create false memories. Suppose if a suspect has visited hypnotherapist to create false memories and you are not sure about his statement, I have already said that BIOS can detect confabulated memory as compared to reality-based memory. And we have published a paper also. You can go through that paper, that confabulation-based memory cannot show experiential knowledge. Experiential knowledge or the memory detected by the brain is only when the person has experienced it. The brain responses will be different if you have experienced an episode as compared to if you have known about the episode from somebody else. Sandra, what is the responsibility of a forensic psychologist in a crime scene? Lot of responsibility, especially if you want to go for psychological autopsy. You need to see the entire crime scene, how it, whether it is an organized crime scene, disorganized crime scene, how the person, whether the person has written a suicide note, it is written in an emotional manner. To do the counseling of the victim, if the victim is alive, for example, in rape cases, murder case, the family of the victim. So for all these things, forensic psychologist is needed. As well as on-the-spot rehabilitation of the victim and family members, even for eyewitnesses. So for initial interview, forensic psychology expert is required at the crime scene. Likita, can hypnotherapy be used as rehabilitative technique to treat criminals? Yes, it can be used. Very good for rehabilitation of criminals. Pariksha, can forensic psychologists take over cold cases? Yes. I have shared one of the papers that is written by Avni, which was published in BPRND journal. You can refer to that publication. In cold cases, if you know the suspect, we can go for a polygraph as well as BIOS testing, and we can find out the truth.
Ma'am, I think we are running out of time. So can we end up the session with the conclusion remarks? And the participants, if you have more questions, you can please put in the email ID of the speaker. She will be replying to you. So Pradeep sir, now I request you to give the concluding remarks.
Yeah, thank you, Lakshmi. Actually, Dr. P.M. Priyanka Kakkar has delivered a wonderful session. And she has explained all the modern deceptive techniques like polygraph, suspect detection system, narco analysis, forensic hypnosis, and all other techniques. It was well presented, and I'm very much thankful for you for your time. And I thank all the participants for your active discussion and being part of the webinar of Indian Criminology and Forensic Science Association. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep sir, Dr. Priyanka ma'am, Lakshmi madam, Dr. Aravind, Annamma ma'am, Dr. Jayesh, my colleagues of ICFSA, and all other participants for your time and attending this session. Thank you all once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for inviting me.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, sir.
Participants, you can mention your name and email ID in the chat box for getting the feedback form. After that, you will be receiving the e-certificates within a week.